No, baby, that's for somebody else. We're just gonna keep you right where you're at right now.
It doesn't matter what you think.
The Wrestling Realm presents Break It Down with Brian H.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this edition of Break It Down with Brian H. I'm your host, Brian H. Waters. This show, of course, is brought to you by The Wrestling Realm. Folks, before we get into today's show, I must pay respects. I must pay tribute. I must honor the first ever, one half of the first ever Black Tag Team Champions of the World. The late, great Rocky Johnson passed away Wednesday, January 15th. We know him as The Rock's dad, but we don't want to just call him The Rock's dad. Rocky Johnson was a legend in his own. Absolutely. His greatest contribution to the business and his greatest gift to the business was gifting us with one of the greatest of all time. Most people, you can even say he's the greatest of all time. Some people would say. But we don't want to just say that's all he was worth, because Rocky was a legend in itself. To be able to do that, to be able to be a tag team champion at a time where people like who look like me, an African-American male, was not getting the opportunities like some of the others were. So, to The Rock, to everyone in his family, from myself, my family, the Wrestling Realm, just want to offer my condolences, my prayers of comfort. So, and to Rocky Johnson, thank you for all your contributions to the wrestling business. Now, folks, we're going to start off. This show is called Wrestling Twitter Strikes Again. So this is going to be an Around the Net sponsor. This show, Wrestling Twitter Strikes Again, Around the Net, brought to you by B Waters Productions. If you have an event that you would like photos of, if you have a event coming up that you want filmed, just let B Waters Productions know. Reaching out to myself, Brian H. Waters, just going on brianhwaters.com or Instagram/B Waters Productions. Folks, Wrestling Twitter has been running wild this week. Actually, since January 2020 came in, things have just been off the chain. But I'm going to start off with the main thing, because I got a lot to say about it. And that's Tessa Blanchard. This past week, she became the first ever woman to win the Impact World Championship. Now, yes, Kimberly was a Shakara World Champion, I believe. But Tessa Blanchard was the first person to become a world champion on modern day television. And what I mean is, you know, big time TV, you know, you're a show that, well, Impact comes on Access TV, but I'm going to put them up there with the USAs and the TNTs. What? Now, I've said before, and anybody who knows me will let you know, I am not a fan of Tessa Blanchard. I've never been a fan of Tessa. I used to work at WSU, and she was the most difficult person I've ever worked with, bottom line. And, you know, that's my show. I'm going to talk about it. It was a time where, before matches, we used to do pre-match photos. And for some reason, she just felt that she didn't have to take the picture. I don't know if it was because I was black. Well, I don't know if it was because she felt I was just some backstage mark. What? Or whatever. But I could tell you, just to name a couple of names. What? Who were on this same show with her. What? Mia Yim. What? Ember Moon. What? Sue Young. What? Chrissy Rivera. What? Allie. What? Those are just a few names. Now, if you look at those names I just named, Sue Young is in Impact with Tessa. But all of these other people are either in AEW or WWE, or they say NXT. They also, with the exception of Chrissy, Chrissy's not in either one of those, but Chrissy has had a Hall of Fame career in CZW. The only woman to compete in the Cage of Death. All these other women treated everybody else with respect. So when these tweets came out, breaking news, I heard the story when it first happened. I just didn't share it. Wasn't mine to share. But when these tweets came out, I was like, wow, the world finally knows the truth about Tessa. And I was listening to my boy. Shout out to my boy Terrence. Make sure you give the Talk About Wrestling podcast a listen. He really talked about Impact Wrestling's pay-per-view. I didn't watch it. Didn't need to. Terrence gave me a good summary. He told me everything I need to know. But, you know, I was sitting there and he brought up a good point. If a lot of people are talking about one thing, maybe you should listen. You had Chelsea Green. So, let me fast forward. Rewind. Kimberly puts out a tweet just talking about, you know, what she did and how she was the first ever women's champion, whatever. Tessa would put out a tweet saying, women, why can't women just support each other? And boy, did she open up the floodgates of hell with that one. I almost called her Allison K. Sienna would tweet about her calling woman of color the N-word and spitting on her. And she was talking about La Rosa de Negra. She brought up this happened in Japan after a show. But you also had a couple other women said they was there. Said they can be a witness that it happened. Chelsea Green said that she didn't show her any respect. Isla Dawn, she wrestled a few times in NXT UK, said Tessa tried to have her blackballed and said that she spread rumors about her. Now, folks, you may believe what you want to believe. You're entitled to. Some people say they want to see evidence. And that's what people do. They always want to see evidence. I can understand that. Sometimes I don't. But when you have all these people, and I understand people want to be Tessa fans, but we have all these people saying something, You know, because I know if I would have told you this story a couple years ago, you wouldn't have believed me. You just wouldn't have. You would have said, oh, that's just some mark, just making up stuff. How do we know? I mean, and to be honest with you, it doesn't mean that I would have known to be fact because I wasn't there. But I could tell you I believe it because of my interactions with her. Did she call me an N-word? No. She wasn't stupid. And no, I'm not saying I would have done anything personally, but she wasn't stupid. Because I definitely would have went on Twitter at that point in time. And I would have made sure the right people knew about it. And I'll just leave it at that. You know, the promoter would have known. And I would have gotten paid and I wouldn't have done the job. That's what I mean when I mean. I said, I'll leave it at that. I guess I just told you what would have happened. But, you know, because I don't tolerate racism. You're not going to treat me like that. But it's also easy to say when you're not in a situation. I'll be the first to admit that. Don't mean that I'm saying I would have backed down. I guess I should say I would have liked to believe. Because we can all say one thing. I'm going to reveal something on this podcast. I'll see how far this reached. There was a guy, ESPN anchor, John Anderson. Yeah, I'm putting his name out there. Like I said, we'll see how far this reached. I'm taking off gloves today. John Anderson. There was a PA, a production assistant, years ago. And this is the hearsay she say. I used to work at ESPN, like I told you guys. He had the production assistant where you did your highlight, you would give it to the anchor, and then the anchor would look over the shot sheet and they would read it. Well, John Anderson decided that this production assistant was below him. And what did he do? He was eating buffalo wings, and you know how messy they are. He was eating buffalo wings. And while he was eating his buffalo wings, and the production assistant went to hand him the shot sheet, he just put the buffalo wing down.
What?
He took his greasy, saucy hands.
What?
And proceeded to wipe them on the production assistant's pants.
What?
Now, I'm pretty sure people are still going to love John Anderson. And there's going to be people who do not believe what I said. And I mean, quite frankly, he's a legend at ESPN to some people. Did I have that same experience with him? No, I didn't. But I'm not surprised. My experience with him was sort of, wasn't as bad as Testa's, because the difference between John Anderson was he knew that he needed me to get his job done. Technically, Tessa didn't need me to get her job done. I was doing social media for the company. It was making her look good as if she was preparing for the match. So technically, she didn't need me, where John Anderson would have needed that production assistant. But my point is that when I found out that story, I was not surprised, because I knew how he interacted with me. And he was very, you know, he wasn't the friendliest guy. He was kind of short. You know, you take a guy like Robert Flores, very nice guy. You take a guy like Scott Van Pelt, straight to the point. Anderson was, when he was talking Brewers, he was good. But when he wasn't, it was a different story. He just didn't like doing social media. But for whatever reason, he wanted to wipe his hands. And my point is, I don't know what I would have done in that situation. I would like to think I would have wilded out, but I don't know. And that's the thing. So, La Rosa De Negra, you know, word on the street, she beat up Tessa. And the issue I have is that Tessa denies this story. And I believe it was Chelsea Green who says the fact, or maybe it was Sienna, says the fact that she denied this story shows that she has not matured. But Impact Wrestling decides, hey, you know what? Still, we're going to make you a world champion. At least, would you say what you want about Hulk Hogan. Say what you want, by all means. At least he apologized. Now, did he apologize because he got caught? Absolutely. Did he apologize because he was in a bad place at that time? Sure. Would he have apologized had we never found out? No, he wouldn't have. And quite frankly, he thought he was in the privacy of his own home. I don't see everybody going out there who's ever used the N-word or something like that in the privacy of their own home apologizing as a safe bet. But in this situation, Tessa was saying it to hurt this lady. She was saying it to demeanor this lady. And that is why Impact Wrestling, I do not respect your champion. Quite frankly, I didn't respect the champion you had before. Yeah, Sami Callihan, yeah, piece of trash also. Wasn't a fan of his, and guess what? You know, he was another one that was difficult to work with. He just didn't want to, you know, when we was trying to work WSU and CZW together, he just didn't want to coexist. That was, so, where you had guys like, you know, Shane Strickland, or I guess you say Isaiah Swerve Scott, who was like, okay, what can we do, you know, to help get the show over, and stuff like that, you know, with Greg Excellent, who was, we had a Kings and Queens tournament, and that's what I'm saying, Sammy just didn't want nothing to do where CZW could have helped elevate that show. He didn't want nothing to do with that, but a guy like Greg Excellent was like, oh yeah, let me figure out what I can do to help. What can we do? Him and Leva Bates team together. It was phenomenal. So, yeah, that's some little inside baseball stuff I witnessed firsthand, stuff I was a part of. But, you know, that's not the only thing on wrestling Twitter this week. Corey Graves apparently tweeted, F this. Fired. I'm already fired. And as of now, 10:30, January 15th, we do not know if that's true, if he's been fired or what. There's been rumors that him and Carmella was both fired. Here's what I will say. I hope that Carmella would not leave her job with the WWE following after a boyfriend. Yes, a boyfriend. Not somebody she's married to, a boyfriend. I would hope so. I would hope not. But, yeah, Corey Graves, he tends to say how he feels. And this is what happens. This is what happens when WWE decided to get into the podcast game. Because he's been very vocal about the Lana and Rusev and Bobby Lashley storyline. That, you know, people are looking at him, okay, what's Corey going to say? What he's got to say about that. And the fact is that I would say WWE just, when they decide to get in the podcast game, they always know they're going to micromanage everything. So fans are going to look at it, especially if you have a podcast of that sort where he's talking about the current product, basically doing what we're doing, doing what I'm doing now, it's still going to be tainted. So after a while, people are like, man, this ain't real. So I guess Corey Graves feels that he has to say things to get the crowd going just so they'll tune in and they won't get bored and think he's some corporate smooge. So that's the thing with him. We'll find out. Obviously, stay tuned to the Wrestling Realm and Brian H. Waters' Twitter feed as we look to see if he has officially been fired. But, you know, sticking with wrestling Twitter. Marty Scurll. Apparently, AEW fans are mad. Scurll signed a huge contract with Ring of Honor. I said Ring of Honor. Yes, Scurll signed a huge contract with Ring of Honor. And not only is he a performer, but he's the head booker. One of the things he said he wants to do is work with All Elite Wrestling, apparently. And I think it's pretty cool, but apparently the AEW fans are upset. All fans are upset. They wanted to see him in AEW. I guess they wanted to see him in NXT. But Marty did what was best for him. Now, I don't know what the figures were. I don't care, honestly. I can't spend it. But I will say that I'm interested to see with him booking what's going to be different. Only time will tell. Let's move on. Triple H and Paige. Yes, we got more, folks. We got more. Triple H apparently was on the show. And they talked about Paige, right? And during that show, he said, no, I'm sorry. He was on the show. They was talking about the injuries. He talked about Daniel Bryan. He talked about how nobody thought Daniel Bryan would get back. But technology and improvements in medicine, boom, Bryan's back in the ring. Now, he also mentioned Edge and Paige. And he said, while they're not back in the ring, they have a quality of life. They could be with their kids. Well, Paige doesn't have any kids, at least none that she knows about.
What?
Yeah, he really said that. At least none that she knows about. And Paige would go on Twitter and say, wow, if my boss makes fun of me, I guess you guys, no wonder you guys still do. And what he was just talking about was her sexual habits, or her sex life, I should say. Now, first of all, it was just inappropriate because everybody knew what she was talking about. We all know Paige, Brad Maddox, and Xavier Woods had an adult film tape together. And there was no need for Triple H to even bring that up in the slightest little bit. And so that just was just ridiculous. Just didn't make any sense at all. And we also had Gabe Sapolsky. Yes, the owner, booker, CEO of Evolve. And David Starr going back and forth on Twitter. And Gabe Sapolsky would go in about a 10 to 12 tweet thread just telling everybody how bad David Starr was and how selfish he was and how he just doesn't play nice with others. Check it out. I tell you that. But I was like, wow, what is going on? We're 15 days into 2020 or 2020, whatever you want to call it. And we have so many people on wrestling Twitter just going at it, trading jabs back and forth. Mind you, we started off with Rory Gulak. Gulak. Yes, Drew Gulak's brother. Rory has been accused of being, dealing with young girls. And you had some women come forth and say that they had consensual conversations with him, but those conversations were not illegal. He just weirded them out. And therefore, by him weirding them out, they wasn't surprised at the actions. And if they've said that he likes young girls, they wouldn't be surprised. I mean, and just the stuff that was being said, it's like, ooh, that's disgusting. So that's the thing. I'm looking at him like, wow, that's interesting. So, yeah, just Rory, you know, I don't know. I believe he's being investigated for child pornography. I can't guarantee it, but I do believe he's being investigated. Man, I tell you, like I said, y'all, wrestler Twitter, it's been off the chain. I'm pretty sure I'm forgetting a few things. I just think, you know, like I said, we start with Tessa Blanchard. I'm going to go ahead and say this. Here we go. I did find it disappointing in Scorpio Sky posting a picture with her. Ariel Monroe saying she talked to both of them and it was squashed. Or I should say Big Swole saying she talked to both of them or whatever. It's like, and then, you know, Kiera Hogan and what's her name, Demonte, saying people make mistakes and all this other stuff. And then, look, I'm being honest with you. I found it disappointing. I'll tell them that. But, hey, I mean, they're entitled to it. Just like I'm entitled to feel disappointed or find it disappointing. Because what I saw was, hey, I'm going to defend this racist behavior. I would have accepted it maybe if Tessa would have apologized. Maybe if Tessa would have just admitted, yeah, I said it. I would even taken, I'm not that person anymore. But to me, she denied it. And then you say, well, maybe, you know, she made a mistake. So that's contradictory, because what are you really saying? If she lied, right? If Tessa lied and said she didn't say it, or LaRosa lied, everybody lied on Tessa. So what are y'all saying? Because y'all basically just telling me she did it. That's all I'm going to say. Enough about Tessa. You know, I'm going to take a quick break. This week, I got my girl, J.O. Rucker, coming on, Breaking Through Glass Ceilings with Brian H. Here's a quick clip. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll be back after this.
I kind of had a moment where I was like, I don't know if I can do this. And I got out there and I did it anyway. And, you know, that whole first game was rough. You know, like people don't even know. And it's not something that I really like, you know, I really talk about a lot. It's something, you know, it's difficult for me to talk about, but they don't even know that morning, like, I had to get dragged out of bed. You know, like, I had to have people help me get dressed. But once I got there, you know, I just felt this sense, because Georgia State, you know, they were on such a high from the Tennessee win, and there were so many people. I got to see so many good friends that night, and it was incredible. And then a couple of weeks later, the idea kind of came to me to start kind of interviewing people the way you're interviewing me through Skype video. And I started off with Coach Katie Pate, who was an assistant coach for Georgia State last year, who I've become close with. And then it's just kind of carried on. And, you know, I'm like, wow, you know, like, I would say that was where I kind of, you know, broke through. And I'm like, I can do this. And
I'm back, ladies and gentlemen. Make sure you are subscribed to Breaking Through Glass Ceilings with Brian H. I got 5 episodes in, folks. We've got 5 episodes with the Fab Five. It's my, you know, you find out the story of me from the storeroom to the boardroom. Where I talk about my journey through Johns Hopkins Medicine, how at one point I was in the nutrition storeroom and now blessed to be able to be amongst the marketing communications team. Then I talked with Kelsey Nelson. One of the things we talked about real heavy was her interview with LeVar Ball, but we talked about her career as a broadcast journalist. Then I talked to my boy Brandon Williams. Brandon, a student at Bowie State University, soon to be finished, but he's also the student representative for the National Association of Black Journalists. And then I would talk to Renee Washington, my sister, who was an All-American soccer player, changing her cleats for the microphone, and now she's a sideline reporter for ESPN Plus, for Fox Sports 1340, for, you know, other companies. And she also has her own podcast, Beyond the Headlines. She also has another, she was on another show, I Do It for Hip Hop. Yes, a lot. And then the round out the first five was my good friend Ashley Baker, who is recording her podcast right now as we speak about nothing but sports. We talked about our time together at Fox Sports 1340 when I recruited her and so forth. So make sure you check out those episodes. And of course, make sure you are subscribed to the Wrestling Realm. You should already be subscribed here. If not, turn your bell notifications on. Drop me a 5-star rating. Let's get into some news. Oh, man. You hear that music? Yes, folks. This young man, David Christopher Benoit, stated he had an interview with the man Chris Van Vliet, and they had a good conversation. And David Benoit said he wants to wrestle. Said he would love to wear his father's gear. He said he has his father's tights. He even said he has an autograph pair of his father's tights, but say he would love to wear his father's tights, you know, the one with the claw, the rabbit Wolverine, and that he would love to come out to the music right there, and he would love to wear, love to be called Chris Benoit Jr. Now, I'm not one to tell anybody how to grieve, how to deal with their father's passing. I've been fortunate enough, I haven't had to deal with that yet. I find it hard to believe a promoter in a major company would book him as Chris Benoit Jr. Unless, real quick, he also talked about Benoit Hall of Fame and how it would be 100% him delivering a speech. He even said he gets chills thinking about it. I don't see that happening, unfortunately. Unless there is a deep study that could almost 100% prove that the man who committed these heinous acts was not Chris Benoit mentally, that the brain really causes you to do something so bad. That's the only way I can see it. And that would have to be, by that time, I'm talking really, really deep study. Honestly, I don't think he would even go into the Hall of Fame until we're all gone, our generation, because you're going to have those people, don't forget them. And I'm going to admit this right here on my show. I'm going to admit this, folks. I did not want to accept the fact that Chris Benoit was guilty. I didn't. I wanted to believe in some of those theories. That maybe somebody had, you know, they said he was on the phone with Chavo Guerrero and the door opened. I wanted to believe that. I wanted to believe that Kevin Sullivan had something to do with. But my goodness, when the man's own flesh and blood, his own son, says they did all the investigations and they did everything, and he had the police look into Kevin Sullivan, he said it happened the way it did, I'd have to let it go. That's just me. I'm just being honest with you. And I can't say, he needs to be in the Hall of Fame, because quite frankly, if that was my sibling or my mother, I wouldn't be saying that. So it's different. It hit home different when it's your family. So I think, you know, putting him in the Hall of Fame would be a reminder to Nancy's sister or Nancy's parents. But it would be nice to see Nancy go in the Hall of Fame. It's just so unfortunate that this tragedy happened nearly 13 years ago. But it just goes to show you the impact of Chris Benoit. This interview may be hard for some people to watch. But David Benoit said he got a lot of it off his chest. I have to say, I'm rooting for him. I would love to see him. If that's what he wants to do, I would love to see him be able to do it. My goodness, he looked just like his dad. I thought Pillman Jr. looked like his father. But my gosh, David Benoit. Austin Gunn looks like him, his dad. But David Benoit looks just like Chris Benoit. You look, and the facial features, the expressions. It's a wow. moving on. AEW has been extended through 2023. AEW and Warner Media has agreed to a second show on another night. Congratulations to them. They want more wrestling. So shout out to D from the Flex Zone says they come in. Here comes AEW Thunder. I hope not. Or maybe, you know what they called it? This is Nitro was now Dynamite. AEW Lightning or AEW Noise. I don't know. Boom. But yeah, we got AEW getting another show soon. I'm wondering how they're going to do this. Are we going to get all the talent? I know the writers are probably like, oh my gosh, now we got to write for TV twice. Because that's what happened when they introduced Thunder. And that's what happened when they introduced WWE SmackDown. Here's another thing. Is this going to be live? Is the show going to be live? Are you going to have like a B show and an A show? And, I mean, like a roster and a B roster. And how are you going to keep up that attractive schedule? So it's a lot of questions that has to be answered. I'm waiting to see. Would they go back-to-back nights? I mean, what night do you put them on? Or morning? Do you put them on Saturday morning? Do you put AEW in that worldwide slot? Or do you even try a Saturday night AEW show? That seems impossible in this day and age. But, you know, you never know. Big news coming from WWE, the news I'm most happiest about, and that's Mercedes Martinez officially signing with the company. Now, anybody knows me knows I've been saying this for a long time. My dream match is Mercedes Martinez versus Charlotte Flair. Yes, I told Mercedes that herself. I said, my dream match is you and Charlotte, and she said it would be an honor. I said this on the podcast before. No, the honor would be for Charlotte to face a legend. Over almost 19 years, she finally gets her opportunity, finally gets her moment. So I'm excited. I really hope they don't keep on NXT too long. But, I mean, the women's wrestler down there is phenomenal anyway. So I'm just glad to see she's in the ring. I just really wish we could get 1 year of Sarah Amato, a.k.a. Sarah Del Rey. But don't think we will. So, and I just got news that I wasn't going to talk about Tesla no more, but it says Impact has just released an uncensored tell-all Tessa Blanchard interview that's sending shockwaves through the wrestling world. Shout out to Blake Thomas, just sent me that. This is what I'm tweeting. Haha, I'm recording my podcast now. I will watch. By the way, just gave you a shout out on this show. Make sure you check out Three Dope Dudes and a Mic on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify. Your name, I listen to Spotify every week. Make sure you check out Three Dope Dudes and a Mic. It's Blake Thomas, Valance Michael, and Ronald James. I promise you'll be entertained. So, moving on. Cain Velasquez will be in the Royal Rumble. God knows, I hope he doesn't win it. I could see him and Brock eliminating each other. Matter of fact, I could even see WWE doing something where Kane and Brock start off the Royal Rumble, eliminating each other, and then they restart, but the Rumble really starts with the number three entry. I could just see them doing that. Remember Austin and McMahon starting off number one, and they beat each other up, and then the third person came out and had to wait? So, who knows? Yeah, there's that. Sad news report, La Parca has passed away. Wasn't too familiar with his work, not to be confused with the La Parca that was in WCW. But like I said, you know, obviously when somebody passes away, I have to offer my condolences to the family and the fans. So, you know, I just, you know, prayers go out to them. So we're moving on. Man, there's so much going on. Matter of fact, let me take a break and then I'll get into this week's action. Got a word coming up to you. Why you should follow the Wrestling Realm.
At some point, here's where I look at it. At some point in time, by the time Bret Hart got gone, the Wolfpack was there. And Sting had joined the Wolfpack. Lex Luger had joined the Wolfpack. Macho Man was with the Wolfpack. And the only person left to defend WCW was DDP. DDP even teased on the Wolfpack. They didn't have Bret Hart doing nothing for the entire year.
And remind these people, Goldberg wasn't, or hadn't arrived yet.
Goldberg wasn't Goldberg.
Right.
It wasn't there.
He was having matches with William Regal getting shown up.
They were still trying to build him to be something that it was, right? It wasn't a whole lot of Team WCW people. There was, at the time, honestly, it was Goldberg coming up and it was DDP. Mm-hmm. Everybody else was Luger, Sting, and those guys were all in Wolfpack at this point, right? Mm-hmm. Here's what I would have did to book it. You knew that Bret Hart was hot off the Montreal screw job. Yep. And that he was pro, okay, he was the traditionalist.
And I'm back, ladies and gentlemen. Make sure you are subscribed to the Wrestling Realm, wherever you can get your podcasts from. Like I said, if you're an Anchor person, you even could go on Anchor and donate some money. If you want to support this show, or maybe you want to sponsor, maybe you have a segment that you want on every week, feel free, reach out to me. You can sponsor, you can pay for a spot, and you can have a spot on the show where, we, you know, every week we talk about it, and it'll be sponsored by your business, which means I'll have to name your business because you guys are sponsoring it. So, moving on, DIY reunites. They will face Mustache Mountain. That is Johnny Gargano and Tommaso Ciampa coming up at Worlds Collide, NXT versus NXT UK. That's going to be exciting. We also had this past week at TakeOver Blackpool, we had the Undisputed Era come out after Walter would retain his championship. The Undisputed Era would come attack him. Now we're getting Walter versus Adam Cole, which that's going to be a match I can't wait for, folks. But they will take on, you know, Worlds Collide should be phenomenal. Taking place in Houston the week of the Royal Rumble. So, and then Isaiah Swerve Scott, mentioned earlier, formerly known as Shane Strickland, became the new number one contender. So he'll take on Angel Garza at Worlds Collide. So don't think he's going to win just yet. That's just my initial thought. I think they're going to go with Garza for a while. But man, oh man, I would be so happy. As you know, Swerve before, you know, he was tearing it up on the indies. Him and Desmond Xavier had some incredible matches. But another place he was at was Lucha Underground. So moving on. AEW Dynamite. We saw Moxley get attacked with a pin by Chris Jericho in the eye. And this is an attempt for Jericho because Moxley is supposed to, you know, he's in the running for the AEW World Championship. So Jericho was attempted to slow him down. But next week, we'll get Moxley versus Pac regardless. And so I believe it's Moxley versus Jericho at the next pay-per-view. I could be wrong, but I do know Pac has probably been the best wrestler, the best character on AEW. I think just the work that he's been doing has been phenomenal. He's been somebody I've been enjoying watching. And for goodness sake, is his name Pac or Pac? He's been Pac all this time. And they call him Pac, so I'm not sure. I thought it was Pac. That's P-A-C. When we see P-A-C, we think Pac. We think Tupac. We think X-Pac. So where do you get this Pac stuff from? P-A-C-K is Pac. Cody Rhodes accepted a challenge from MJF. Now, they had three, like, stipulations on there. One was a steel cage with the Warlow. And one of the things Cody said was that steel cage could be a thing where MJF would be exposed and the fans would see it. Warlow is more that he shouldn't be carrying MJF's bags, but MJF should be carrying his bags. But yeah, we got that match. We also got the other stipulation was he couldn't touch MJF for till the pay-per-view and then taking 10 lashes. So I'm not sure what they're doing with this, but I do like that we got Cody versus MJF coming up. I want to see them, like, you know, I don't want to see MJF wrestle until then. I don't think he should have wrestled yet, but this will certainly be interesting. Moving on to some other news. Hangman Page and Omega, the number one contenders for the tag team titles. But I tell you this, when I turned it on, they did not look like buddies that was going after titles. They looked like it was an issue between those two. So I don't know what's going on with Adam Page and Kenny Omega, quite frankly. But we'll see. And then, did you know that NWA will be taking on ROH as Nick Aldis, the world's champion, will be taking on Flip Gordon coming up? I think this is pretty cool. You got two companies who kind of, you know, they focus on the wrestling aspect. It's like the wrestlers first, the story is second. So I'm interested to see where they go with this. Will Flip Gordon become a NWA world's champion one day? Only time will tell. And shout out to Bianca Belair. She won the Women's Battle Royal. She is the new number one contender for the NXT Women's Championship. Now, we know a year ago around this time, Bianca Belair was in the same position. We thought that it would have been at this point where she would have won the championship. Then when she didn't, so that's okay, she'll get it in WrestleMania. That did not happen. I don't think she gets the title just yet, but I'm also confused because she looked to be doing babyface things after winning the match, but then I thought she was a heel. Now, I think it would make more sense for her being a heel since she's going against Rhea Ripley, and I don't see Rhea Ripley relinquishing that title anytime soon. So that's a little disappointing, to be honest with you. But I wouldn't say this is a wasted win for Belair, even though she was built up, and this is why I said it before, and I'll say it again, I do not like undefeated streaks in wrestling, because when you build them up, where is the payoff? The payoff to me should have been, she should have been the champ, but she wasn't, and that's what happened. So it's now like, what do you do? So I do think we'll get a good matchup between those two, so I'm really excited about that. So now it's time to go from the realm before I wrap the show up.
And now for this week's questions from the realm.
So, from the realm, one question coming from the shark. Make sure you check out the Sean Williams Podcast Network. And it says, three guys from each brand. Could Brock be eliminated? He wants three guys at the Royal Rumble. Could three guys from each brand name? Let me start that over. He wants my three guys from each brand who could do it. I was really thinking about this, right? And this is what I came up with. Three guys. I'm going to start with Monday Night Raw. I'm going with the obvious pick, Drew McIntyre. But that's the matchup I want to see. I think that's a money matchup right there. Number two, Bobby Lashley. Lashley Lesnar has been a match we've been waiting to get for years, and we have not gotten it. And then number three, I got to go with the Viper, Randy Orton. Randy Orton has been on a different role, and I think there could be a build-up to a rematch right there. We know what happened before, so I think if we got that rematch, it would be pretty dope. Then, we also have from SmackDown. Now, this is tough. I don't want to see Braun again. However, if you wanted to get Braun going again, if you packaged it in a way that he could finally get the job done, it would make sense. Then there's The Fiend. Now, The Fiend is the WWE Universal Champion, but you could do something where he would do it and then you set up maybe a title for title match. Or you have The Fiend drop the title to Daniel Bryan and then go back and seek revenge. So that's another one. And then the third man, I'm not going to say Roman Reigns. That's too obvious. Just looking at the build, the history there. So I'm not going to say him. I think, quite frankly, that might be lazy of me to do so. But I'm going to surprise you with this one. I'm going to say Big E. Now, how cool would it be to see Big E the year after Kofi and he go back-to-back WrestleManias where the New Day will win? Big E has the size. It would be believable. You tone down the joke because Lesnar doesn't come to joke around. And I think you create a nice mean streak within Big E. And there you go. So those are the three guys I think could do it. So we shall see. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to wrap things up this week. Appreciate you guys listening. Yeah, I'm going to check out this Tessa interview that I was sent. Maybe I'll talk about it on the next show. So we'll see. Episode 109. But make sure you subscribe to the Wrestling Realm. Make sure you are hitting the bell notification if you're listening on YouTube. Yeah, maybe one day I'll whip out the cameras again. But make sure you hit the bell notification. That way, you are notified each and every week I drop a new episode. Make sure you check out my other show, Breaking Through Glass Ceilings, with Brian H. Just simply going on iTunes. Give me 5 stars. Appreciate you, everybody. Thank you for joining this episode of the Wrestling Realms. Break It Down with Brian H. So long, everybody. P.S. I checked out the interview right before I did post production. And guess what? It was a parody. Somebody put together a mashup of Tessa's interview. And they added a black man's voice asking her how does she feel about the N-words. Very clever. Very funny. It's always good to see a parody. But, all right, I'm out.